you were there at that time, is those were the initial days of lockdown, and those were also the initial days of Zoom. So people were not that very familiar, and you know, we were ourselves learning that. So obviously we did not have the recording, and we did not have the Facebook Live and all at that time. Okay, then from there it took on, and now, as all of you know, that we have 50 sessions. Except three, all other videos are available in YouTube, in Facebook. You all can go and watch that. And today is the 50th session, and we want to have a specially curated program today. Okay. So we have two friends. That is how I would like to describe them, who are also artists, okay, who are two fantastic human beings, and who both of them are separated by maybe 13 years or 12 years or 14 years, but then have a lot of similarities in the thinking and the career which they pursued. So today, Aji is in the hot seat, and he has been part of our program, and he used to attend in this when he was based out of Netherlands. He used to log in from there, and he used to be pretty active for this. So Sujit is the person who is conversing. And this program also marked Sujit as an interviewer of artists. Okay. So that is another thing which had happened in the course. You know, so when a good program happens, a lot of byproducts will emerge. You know, yeah. So this is something. So vyathyasthanaya Sujithine satyathil aaru thirichirunnilla. I'm sorry for that Malayalam. So the translation is that people didn't recognize the different Sujit other than the Sujit Hassan, the artist of landscape poets. Now giving a brief about Aji, which is actually my role. As many would know, he did his BFA from College of Fine Arts, Trivandrum. And then he did his MFA from Delhi College of Art. And then he has been in this domain for close to three decades. A host of shows, solos, and group. And then he had a teaching stint in between, in Trivandrum College. So he has been a teacher, he has been an artist, and I think his works are part of many prestigious collections, including the, Netherlands government agencies. So today we thought, as it is the final episode of season one, there can't be a better suited person than Aji to be in the hot seat today. So I would hand over this dais to Sujit now. Thank you, Aji. Thank you, everyone else. Sujit, part of our team and curator, will lead from us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. And it's 50th, so it's like I'm a bit overwhelmed by your love and support. You know, like it's not that easy to have 50 sessions, you know, in a for an online platform. So thank you all for part of it, and thank you for the support, and thank you Nirachartha and team Nirachartha, especially Mr. Satish, for giving me this opportunity and exploring something which I you know, somehow I'm you know, working, you know, something like interviewing somebody, you know, this is my third experience, or third or fourth, therefore. And thank you very much, Aji, for accepting our invitation. And you are my dear friend and a fantastic artist. So I'm extremely glad and honored to have a conversation with you. And we sometimes talk like 2-3 hours in a stretch. So hopefully we get a, you know, like something which evolved in this 1 hour platform. So hopefully I'm hoping for the best, and let's begin. Yeah, thank you. Welcome, Aji, to the.
Thank you, Vinod, and everybody.
Thank you. Yeah. So we'll start with the with your beginning of your career, like as an artist. You know, like as a young, maybe more than that, like as an from your childhood. You know, like how you start this, you know, like as a how did it begin this? And I know there are few teachers which really support you in the beginning, not two teachers especially. I know that, like in our conversation, you always mention them. So how it starts?
No, I started. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. I was doing drawings and things like that from my childhood onwards.
Mm-hmm.
I am very lucky that everybody around me had supported me. They had seen that I have a talent, and then my teachers, even in the first school class, mm-hmm. my mm-hmm. first standard teacher mm-hmm. had told me to paint two parrots and draw two parrots on the blackboard. That is how I started my class, not in my school, mm-hmm. first standard. So that was great. You know, that gave me a lot of confidence to go to school. And then later, you know, all of my teachers, you know, mm-hmm. had seen and
yep.
I need to paint, and you know, they supported me to
So then you moved from Calicut to Trivandrum
when I was in 8th standard, my mm-hmm. I was studying in Thiruvangur High School in Calicut.
Okay.
And the headmaster had told my father that I should go to Trivandrum to join mm-hmm. the Fine Arts College, and that is my father to take a transfer to Trivandrum.
Okay.
Yeah. So my father also agreed with that suggestion, we all family moved to Trivandrum,
for your art education.
Yes. I started continuing my classes in a school in Trivandrum, okay. and then also the headmaster was very much happy with me to see. He presented me first. My first drawing board and board big players, mm-hmm. and okay. took me to a school where. My teacher, Govindan Ajari, that was his name.
Yep.
And he had a small institution there called Ganga Arts.
Okay.
And then I started oil painting, learning oil painting under him. Then I was in 9th standard.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how was your experience in Trivandrum College of Fine Arts? When you studied there, the radical movement was in peak. So what, yes. you took another yes, direction.
I am in the right place. I am at my home.
Yeah. That's what you say, yeah. Yeah. So but you took, you didn't take, the radical painting and painters and sculptors. That was in the peak. But you didn't take that direction. You took a different direction. Yes. Which is, yes. Yeah. No, because
you I have some ideas about it. And I have friends in my class. And we had discussions, I had a feeling that artists, mm-hmm. had to be not in a group, but he has to be, stand alone and, do his work mm-hmm. that kind of ideas we had in the art faculty.
So what are the influences in that?
Seniors were influencing me,
mm-hmm.
like Jodi Basu, Ramyan, Harindran,
mm-hmm.
all of this,
mm-hmm.
everybody was supporting
mm-hmm.
me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
We used to have great discussions and,
Also the artists, Western artists like there are many influence you.
Oh, at that time we had
Lamende,
expressionist.
Yeah.
It was very much popular.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also when Egon Schiele and,
Enzo Cooke and
Yeah.
Cooke and Lamende.
And now they came later.
Okay, they came later. Okay.
Yeah, when I was, I you know, I.
But started. Mostly the German expressionism, which is
That was, you know, in Trivandrum College of Fine Arts. That was
So then later you moved. Yeah.
Yeah.
So see, there are something which we are our interests are in common and our preoccupations are in common. One actually is like especially the kind of visual rhythm, you know, the kind of visually how to attain that sort of a very organic structure through a painting, which actually very evident from the since long time, like in your painting. So how did you arrive in it, you know, like, which is even I'm very interested in it, you know, like it's very organic. It's not, there is nothing like very superficial or not something very artificial. It is more, it's something look like somewhere it happened, you know, but
yeah,
the images
like that. In the beginning, it was not like that. Slowly, I understood that basic, you know, visual, what we call fundamentals of visual art. That is always, that is the medium, not what we are really, what we call the subject matter. Mm-hmm. It lies in the color, in the forms, in the, you know, that sort of basic of visual art, that I understood later. So I started moving towards that.
Okay, so slowly it came to you. So when you go to Delhi College of Arts, like how do you choose that, like that college? For what is the reason behind it? Because that's not that popular. The college is not that popular because most of the people go to Baroda or Shantiniketan later maybe.
My friends also told me to go to these institutions, Baroda or Shantiniketan.
Mm-hmm.
But I was very much fascinated. You know, I had visited Delhi with my school, what we call All India study tour.
Yeah.
I was in Delhi and I have seen that what Delhi can offer. Like I was much interested in music, in cinema. To see museum and that kind of things. And that was very, you know, when I was in Delhi, I saw all these things are there.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the main reason I chose this institution. So I was like more listening to music, every day going to music concerts, and going to Lipkala Academy Library.
Yeah.
Then to cultural embassies of different countries to see to listen or to see cinemas.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, Delhi had a very there was so much thing happening in Delhi.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what fascinated me actually.
There you met many musicians and all like.
Oh that. Yes.
Yeah,
you artists, met musicians.
Yeah.
Actually, my life was out of the institution, out of the college, actually.
Mm. So you learned from that.
Yeah.
And also the so your early works to now, like there is a strong sense of balance in terms of the figuration and all. So is that it's somehow connected to the Indian sculpture and Ajanta painting and Far Eastern, you know, the scroll painting and the Japanese. How do you see that as a Japanese or Chinese Japanese scroll painting, watercolors and all? So how do you see that, that connection? Is it because of you are there in Delhi? That's a reason?
One reason to go to Delhi was when I finished my studies in Trivandrum College of Fine Arts. Mm-hmm. I was very much, very much enthralled by European art, but I was not aware about Indian art.
Okay.
one reason was now there was a lot of nicely printed books about European art, but there was very black and white, gray colored books about Indian art, and I couldn't see really good plates. But then I thought there was a problem that I didn't think that Indian art is something secondary, but I understood that is my problem. That somehow I couldn't connect to it. So I understood that I should learn, I should get more familiar with Indian classical art, Indian art history. And that so because of that reason, as I went to in New Delhi, because I had seen that in National Museum there is a great collection of art. I could go there and see them, familiarize them, and so every weekend I was going to a National Museum and going around just looking at them and familiarizing them. So that is how I get more familiarized with Indian art.
Okay. So
I see all these things working.
Also, you can see the original, no? Like the,
the
museum.
I believe that artworks you have to see the original, because that gives you the experience. That opens your eyes. But seeing a photograph or reading about them doesn't make much sense to me.
Okay. So most of your most of your works are connected to the landscape. You are not a landscape painter. I don't call landscape painter as landscape painter, but because it's not a mere documentation of a place, it's not a mere documentation of a socio-political situation of a land or eco-political idea. But you are taking landscape as a career of saying something larger, through that. So, which is mostly somehow misunderstood by people. They think it's a landscape painting. It's because of India has a very short landscape painting history. They can't connect to a landscape painter, which is mostly company painting or something later. They are more like a documentation. So how do you react to it?
Now, when I saw Indian miniatures, and most of them are landscapes, rendered in it, and very much deeply studied. If you see them, you can see that the artist was observing them, studying them, and taking very seriously about the flora and fauna and the landscape geography of it. And all these things are in the miniatures. So saying that Indian art doesn't have that landscape, not really right, actually.
Okay.
They were always there. And somehow later that become a backdrop to other things.
Yep.
But in our period, I think landscape has more importance. Paint them, to observe them, and bring them back into the
in the scene.
That is how
But the miniature paintings are more like there will be a major event or a person. The landscape is always like a curtain, right? Like it's always a behind scene. So you are not painting in that way, right? Like there is there is no such major event in your painting. Like it, everything is equal. That is again an Indian idea of painting, right? Like everything is equal. Like it's a little spiritual, but it's actually truth. Like in your case, I am also interested in. Like everything is equal. There is no major event. There is no prime focus, or there is no protagonist sometimes. There is no such thing,
right?
So, but when you're talking about the miniature, there will be a king or something or some event. Even in Geet Govinda, those paintings, like Krishna is always in the prime focus. There is no focus as such, but yeah, that is there actually.
Yeah, I understand.
But in your case, there is no such.
Oh, in that time, painting a landscape, or you know, that was not that much important. But in nowadays, painting and giving a special importance to landscape is very, very reasonable, I think, in our time.
Okay.
You know, that thinking take me to paint them, and also I see that through painting landscape, you can bring all kind of human issues into that.
Yep.
I can bring my own issues, my the issues of my land, issues yep. of humankind. Everything is yep. I can bring in that.
Yep.
So that is how I approach them now.
Okay.
You can see in this drawing also, because the landscape is actually breaking away, is eroding. You know, that may be a reason before completely erode, I wanted to paint them.
So
that is one reason.
Okay, that is one of the, but there are painters in Western painters like Amslam Kiefer and many such landscape based artists. You know, they are more into landscape, and they through the landscape they are Hockney or so they use that as a vehicle to say something. So you also taking that path in a way.
Yes. It's in a very flexible medium, like another flexible thing, like painting a landscape. You can, you can paint a tree as you want. You can, if the balance is not right, you can put another tree on the side.
Yeah.
I am not painting looking at a landscape and painting it, but I am building my own landscape.
Okay. Now,
very arranged, very organized.
Yeah. Right. So I always feel that like painting has its any art form, especially painting has its own justice system, you know. So everything you can do it there, and you can break that. You have a liberation to do whatever you want to, but when you're talking something through logical, you're showing something through logical, it is more like it's a little more impactful, you know, like it has a science, right? Like every time there is a science involved in it. So in your case, you are very much interested in it. Like you are very much you are very clear that like how things we perceive, you know, how we think, how we look at something. So you always take that logic, you know, you take the liberation at the same time, but you also place them in a very logical ground. So how did you really arrive? Are you really interested in science?
Oh, I am very much interested in science. Physics is my favorite subject.
I
studied in my pre-degree. I took science subjects, biology, botany, zoology, chemistry, physics. Now all these things were my favorite subjects. Still they are, apart from art and philosophy.
So you keep updating yourself. What is happening? Yeah, I know that. I'm asking some question for the because most of the time people think it is, you know, just an imagination, you know, just you are doing it. But I know we travel together.
But imagination is there, sure.
Yeah, I know that, but it's not completely rely on imagination. You are placing them into a logical ground, which I'm more interested, you know, because
logic comes in a different way. Like when I was doing this drawings, for example, charcoal drawings.
Yeah,
you know. These are very dusty, powdery things, and it shows me that everything now comes from dust. You know, the whole universe came into being from the dust. That way, I can make a painting from the dust. I can make all images the powder, the other tool, and become the become the image, become the. I'm making a new, what we call, new reality, or making an another reality.
Through the dust theory and
becoming of the universe, you know, the same way, you know, my drawings also come into being from the dust. That is how my understanding about the physics or the, everything comes into art,
So these are influenced by from these three graces painting, and also the Indian sadhus from from what do you call that, Kumbh Mela or something.
I wanted to paint my grandparents. I imaged them as this kind of beings, they are like, I mean, they are very old, grandparents. So I thought they may be like this, natural beings.
So the lighting also very special in it, like there is light within, there is no source of lighting sometimes. There is no such prime focus on certain part of a body also. There is, everything is almost again same. There is, it's again maybe a miniature influence, because they don't put any shadow, right? Like you also not, you're not interested in shadow. But at the same time, you are getting that, especially cast shadow. There is no cast shadow in your painting. Like, so these are like, how did you really, like, you are thinking when you're making, or like you planned everything and then you start painting? Like,
no, I plan things, but slowly, because before painting this, these figures, I started painting groups of people. You know, then I can study them, and slowly, slowly, I was not confident enough to paint one, one figure and make an artwork out of that. So I started painting groups of people. Then, so I studied the different kind of, postures, and then made smaller groups like this. And then I slowly got confidence to paint a, one figure on, like, confronting the person, just face on. So I need some confidence for that.
Okay, so you
really build up.
So you take references from different part of the, the scene, or it just starts from the.
References come from all sides, from everything. From the photographs of, as you said, Aghara Baba, Naga Babas, or other painters, so from everything, wherever it gets, I absorb them.
Yeah, and the mudras, you're putting some sort of a mudra, sort of a...
They are not really mudras, but they came like that, by painting. So then it become like that. So I didn't think about this mudra and thought that it will, it has a particular meaning and gave that meaning. I didn't think like that. While painting, while drawing them, it became like that. And, then when I saw them, it opens my own eyes also. For me, while painting, things get, I also understand things through, through the act of painting or drawing. It reveals many, many things to me on the act, by doing the pay, doing the art.
So how do you, how do you segregate them? Like, that is not a compromise. This is not compromise. This is accepting something, right? Like, there is a slightest demarcation between compromise and accepting thing. So where do you, like, how do you choose, how do you decide that? When you completely rely on accidents, or completely, like when you accept the or welcoming the accidents. So how do you demarcate that?
No, it is just it is like if you are not satisfied what is happening, you change them.
Okay.
Yeah, this paint, these drawings are not. Now I took long time. I rubbed them away and again redraw them.
Yep.
Till I am satisfied. So on the process, I get there. You know.
So you keep revisiting some of your work, right? Like, do that? Like, because there are certain time, like the idea of, if for an example, the idea of perfection, it's relative, right? Like it's keep changing, right? Like sometimes this is perfect for you. Mm-hmm. And later you earn little skill or you earn little more understanding of art and then it become something different, right? Like it's not that what actually you, it's actually a very slippery thing, like the idea of perfection. So how do you, revisit the ideas?
No, I haven't actually, I didn't, because new ideas come, so I wanted to revisit them actually.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Now I get new ideas, new things come, so I never get the chance to revisit them. I hope I can go back and, you know, but each of my drawings, actually, you know, there are a lot more drawings I can make in that way. But while doing, new ideas, new things comes up and then I have to go there, leaving these ideas and things, you know.
No, you
leave them and go to the next thing. I hope I will get enough time, or one day I will come back and do some more.
Revisit.
Yeah.
Yeah, because sometimes I feel there are certain works you just left there. You know, like you could have gone a little more ahead because.
Yes, I also think so.
Yeah, because there is a possibility. You know, like sometimes, sometimes things take time. No, like to evolve to. So that sometimes you are not giving that much time, which I observed
the new ideas comes and new things comes. Then you wanted to do them, like this drawings, this pastels, oil pastels, dry. Dry pastels on paper.
Yep.
And I wanted to do some more, but then I have some other things to do, other ideas comes up, another, and I get enthusiastic about that.
Yeah.
That I will come back and later continue them. But, you know, until now, it didn't happen.
Yeah.
You know, now I'm doing oil painting. So, you know,
So your most of your early works, especially these sort of work, which share some sort of it emphasizes some sort of a silence and stillness, you know, which is I'm quite interested in it. You know, like I also from my beginning I'm very interested in how to get that, you know, the stillness and the same time how to emphasize that, you know, like through but the same time there is a human presence in it. But when it comes to your recent work, you are somehow moving from that, you know. Most of your recent works has a direct human presence, you know, like somehow there are people standing there, or somehow there is a build-up, you know, something building or something. So why actually it is happening? Why you took that turn?
I don't know. These are conversions from inside. Maybe there are a lot of reasons for that. Many reasons. When I paint, I get a lot of reasons.
Okay.
There are many reasons. So I cannot say them actually.
It's not because of the urgency of to interfere, or to have a direct. I don't call message, but direct intervention through landscape. Is it because of that? The time change, no? Like from that to now, like maybe 10 years, 20 years, things are changing, right? Like, so you can't say, sometimes like you wanted to say something very direct or something little more, obvious. Is it because of that?
I don't know. My old works, I was, I was not really really studying things, and I'm just painting them from my or my my mind or my but now I understood that I had to learn more, study more. So this kind of paintings now give me an opportunity to observe things and study them.
Okay.
So
these are Kerala landscape.
Right? Yes, so, these are the now these are the scene from my studio in Kochi. I had a short for a short time. I had a studio in Kochi, and I could see them. This is a scene from the window of my studio.
Yeah, okay.
So I could observe the trees and look at them and study them. And in my early drawings, there is not that much.
Can you go to early drawing? Yeah. So this is.
They were more imaginative things.
Okay.
See, these are more imaginative things.
Okay.
There are studies, but I'm study them, and then then they come from imagination. But the later drawings are more observation and more realistic in a way.
So how color comes to you? Like, is it, it's not exact color sometimes?
No, so, they are not at all exact colors.
Yeah,
no.
They are not exact colors. Mostly,
I understood that, or my belief is that color can work with the psychology of the onlooker. So I wanted to prepare the onlooker, prepare their psychology through the color. So standing in front of them, I like in a color field
abstraction
theories. So this color will prepare the onlooker to approach the images or the painting in a peculiar reality.
So the Rothko sort of abstraction,
which
influence, because when I see sometimes. Some of the area of your painting, which is look like very flat, but you paint it carefully. You paint them.
Each part is painted very carefully. Each corner, each inch of it is. I have a very conscious approach.
So that's okay. So can you
flat color or a corner which is which looks bad, and it is very consciously made like that.
Okay.
Nothing is really, really accidental, when you are painting, things are, you may see that things are coming in, but I believe that they are not accidental because you make that space for them to come in.
Yeah, true.
So they are not just coming in.
The accidents, the one should rectify the accidents, otherwise there is no accident also.
Yeah, and this is not like your hand is just your cup of coffee is just fallen down. Not like that.
So
you make a space so these things come in. You make a space for them to come in, and I accept them. I observe them, and I see their importance, and then let them be there. If they are not, I couldn't see the importance. I paint them again.
I know the last painting which you had a show now, like in red, the show in Mirchand. Steenbrook. So that painting took a long, long time, which I... I know that because you always update, sometimes you say that it's almost done, it's over. And then you start again, and then you go back. And then sometimes you get a better result. Sometimes I don't like it, and then you go for you go through again, and then
As a painter, hard life as a painter.
Yeah, that's what I just felt that, you know, like it's really.
So many of my friends also come and say it is done, it is very good, and it is enough, it is finished. But next day I come and see that it's not done. It is not like that has to be. So I continue working and then change them. Then you know, then when you change them, everything is you know broken apart. Then you have to bring them again. Then new things comes.
Yeah.
You know, once I remember I had told you Vikram and Vedal's story.
Yeah, I remember, yeah. So the each story takes back the basic, yeah. So how you decide then, like, okay, this is done now. It's at least for time being, you know, it's over.
Exactly. You know, that, for that I told you the story of Vikram and Vedal. Because all these stories, finally, Vedal feel pity to the King Vikramaditya, and decided that to ask a story which has no answer.
Yeah,
That's how it finished. Painting also like that. Now, finally, painting don't ask you any story, any questions.
Okay.
Then you stop.
Okay.
And that is the end of the painting. It ask a question which doesn't have an answer.
Okay. So, don't you think it become an entity and it started asking questions?
Yeah, it become an entity itself.
Yeah, entity, and then you started asking, don't touch me in this way.
Yeah,
don't abuse me at least. You know, like.
Yeah. It's also towards the artist.
Yeah, it dictates you. Yeah.
Can rest. Nice that that kind of.
Yeah,
the painting is demanding things. You know, you cannot escape.
Yeah. So is it tough to touch your old work again? If somebody asked you to touch again, can you just work this part?
It is very difficult because it is not a manual. Manual labor is, it's not a job. And so when I do, I can only create, not recreate. Recreation is not my job, creation is my job.
Okay.
So touching, retouching, all these things are recreations.
Okay.
That is not artist's job, actually. Artists cannot do that.
Okay. So how do you react if somebody, like, especially in Kerala art scene, like, most of them are behind this this message making, the painting should have a message, not even message, sometimes it's more than that, like slogan hearing or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
How do you react that sort of a painting,
basically painting should be a potent enough to answer all the questions raised by the viewer. But in fact, painting is not only an answer. It's an entity which you can now answer all kind of questions, and should be able to answer answer them.
So it's more like the question is important than the answer, right? Like there is no signboard as such through painting. Like you go this way.
In my painting is not. No.
Yeah. In your painting,
In my painting is not. They are their own way. They are confident enough to stand in its own legs. You ask a question that painting should be ready to answer you.
Okay.
Now it's up to the viewer. What kind of question they ask my job is to make the painting rich enough to potent enough to answer this question. Mm-hmm. They are like natural. They came into being naturally.
Mm-hmm.
Like in a nature, a tree become a tree.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ask any, you can approach with any question to that tree.
Yeah.
And you could also find answers, but the answer is actually comes from yourself only, not from the tree. but sure. Enough from yourself only. That way, the penny should be you know, be there to give what we call consciousness, that you know, that awareness. Mm. Provide the awareness to the viewer to get their answer.
Okay.
Painting is not the answer.
Mm. Yeah.
But you know, but if it is nicely painted, it's balanced, it stands on its own legs, then it gives you that awareness to get the answer.
So it is more like an experiential way.
Yes, yes.
It's not like you don't need any external support, like a big node.
No.
Yeah, even I believe.
Like anything in the nature. It's, you know, painting should naturally come into being.
Yeah, not true.
Like whatever comes into being in the nature.
Mm-hmm.
That is my idea.
Yeah, which I observe even in mostly the masters, you know, Bruegel or Bosch or whatever. Though Bosch works are more like a very absurd idea, but he plays them as a testimony, you know, like he has seen somewhere, this is what happened, I've seen it. So then he plays his idea through that. So somehow I also felt that in your works, you know, like you place them a little more logical way, you know, this is what happened, I've seen it. So that clarity one should achieve through painting, right? Like
thank you, it's a great
time. Yeah, which I felt, you know, like there are few artists who have that too. So maybe that because of the time and the way you paint, maybe because of that, you're getting that, I feel, you know, like also the references from, we all share sometimes, like, Piero della Francesca to Balthus and then Morandi, you know, like
yes.
Morandi and then, yeah, they all, you know, they paint something which is not, you know, which is, they approach on painting itself is a, it's their message, right? Like, so that's why I also felt that in your case.
You know that, as I told you that, you know, all these questions which you can answer, you know, arrived by the painting.
Yeah.
You know, then finally, now there the painting answer a question which doesn't have any answer. So I cannot answer it. Then I stop. You know, that is the end of the painting. Then it is there, you know.
Okay, so when you decide this painting is not working, how do you decide that? Like, how do you say this? Like, there are many works I've seen that, like, you didn't show it. Mm-hmm. You have number of works in your studio.
It's just like, it's very simple.
That gallery street might
know that. Like, you know, it just don't satisfy you, you know? Mm-hmm. Then it is not done.
But don't you think you also underestimating or you're measuring yourself, like, okay, this is what I know, so this is not working, so I'm not, so it means that, like, you know yourself.
Well, I don't know myself, you know, that's a big question. but how to say that? So when you ask me, you know, I become in a big problem because I know that, you know, this is myself, you know, knowing myself,
yeah.
I haven't reached there.
So sometimes because I establish my doubts through my works, you know, I'm shameless in that way. Like sometimes I send something which I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Which you are not doing because you came in a different time and then situation where you are from your first work, maybe in a gallery, maybe, which I've seen it in 2008 or something, like, or later 2010 or something.
2007?
Yeah.
My first short solo.
No, 2007. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I think.
Yeah, first solo.
Yeah, first. From that, you keep, you know, like your best works are at least three or four best, and most of the works are in a level. You don't show your doubts. So it means that like you are clear about yourself.
No, if I was clear about, I won't, if I was satisfied, I won't move.
You don't paint again.
My painting is changing.
Yeah.
And I never done something again and moving towards new things.
Yeah.
That shows that, I'm not completely satisfied.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it is some other maybe
ongoing process, ongoing thing, And my, what I wanted to paint are new things, actually.
Okay. So the conviction change, your vishwasam maarikondirukka. Like you wanted to change the...
My convictions are not changing because whenever I see, I have a lot of convictions about painting by seeing masters. Paintings by masters.
Okay.
So they are still there. So that gives me my drive also. Because I know them. So I wanted to reach there. I know there. That is the place I wanted to be in. So you try on. You strive on to get there.
To get, okay.
In different ways. This is not what happening, you go in another way to catch it. It is not, if you are not able to get it through that way, you get another route.
So
I wanted to be there. That is the point.
Yeah, but I know that as an artist, you are always working, always working.
Yes.
But it is almost like a cattle has a grass to eat every time, there is no need to go out and you are going out in a way, but every time you are getting it, something.
But I am not grazing on the same field, eh?
Yeah, I know.
When the grass is over, I go to the next field.
So you keep working in different directions and different things.
Oh, yes, it is, yes.
Yeah, so.
You can see that my drawings and how I, I try many things. My early works and what I am doing, the new works, they are different in a way.
Yeah, but you are focused now. Have you any idea of where you are heading?
Any idea
of where you are really, what actually your plans are?
One thing I know, I am going to an unknown area.
Area,
so I don't know anything, but. Yeah. I know there is an area like that.
Yeah.
There I want to go, but I haven't been there. I don't know. It's unknown. But I know that that is there. So I wanted to go there. So I cannot say.
Okay.
Great. When you reach up, like once I told you, if you are a mountaineer, when you climb on a hill, then you see the mountain behind it. Before that you don't see the mountain. You are just the hill is hiding the mountain.
Okay.
When you climb up the mountain, you see climb up the hill, you see the mountain behind.
Then
you see, oh, that is the mountain I had to climb. Then you climb that one, then you see there is the biggest one behind it. Now they just get revealed in front of you. If you have traveled in mountains. If you're trekking in mountains, that's a real experience, just like that. Until then, I don't know where even their existence is not known. Only when you reach a level, then from there you can see, the area you wanted to reach. When where you are there, then you see the next step. Until then, you are unaware. You have no idea.
Okay.
Unknown.
So, what is the difficult time in a painting? It depends on a painting, but early few hours are very difficult, right? Like hell, there's labor.
Labor is laborious.
Because you have to fill the color and then you play, right? Like slowly you get the grip and then you play. So those are the difficult time for you, like, or you enjoy that also to some extent?
I enjoy every inch of the art making. From the beginning onwards, because when you are doing this thing, also you are mentally, you are mentally you are clearing your thoughts. You know, you are getting more into it. You see more. You know, so there's a process in the beginning itself.
Mm-hmm.
So I enjoy that. Okay. That gives me slowly clarity to things.
Mm.
I start from nothing, not only a kind of vague idea of what it is, what I wanted to make. Only start making it become clearer to me.
So how do you decide the size then?
So in many that is also kind of your No, it depends upon your enthusiasm,
Okay. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes you have a lot of enthusiasm to make a bigger painting, then the ideas become like that, So you do that. Sometimes you wanted to make a small painting, which, it depends upon your mind and your situation. Now, many things. It's all
so
related.
It's not now, it's also because of the, to create an ambience, maybe it's a large, yet sometimes when you are in front of that, like, you feel that you are inside the painting, that's also one.
I make oil paintings which is 2 meter high, and because that height related to my size actually. As a human being, it has a kind of connection to my own body. I reflect, in that size, I can reflect my own body into that. So the painting become myself in a way. If it is so huge, I know that I am not so huge. So. I find the kind of size which is suitable to my own size. I can project myself on it.
So how do you choose? How do you choose the medium? Each medium has its own possibilities, and its
that's
own
also temperament. Like your
that's also
temperament. Your temperament decides.
True. But you're more into this organic medium. You never work in acrylic. You never work very plastic.
Some mediums I can think with it. Think. That kind of mediums I choose. Somehow these are the mediums which I can continue my thinking. Now I can develop my thinking. I can, it helps me to think also.
So it helps you.
Mediums I like.
It helps you with it's kind of a give and take. It gives you something and then you take something up. Okay, so that way it moves to. So that is your temperament towards him.
Yes.
Okay. So I think we reached in our time. I think anything you.
Now somebody wanted to ask some questions, I will be very happy to answer.
Okay. That's amazing. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Haji.
Yes, thank you. It's a short time, actually. Normally, we talk longer.
Yeah, that's true. I'm also struggling to be precise and too formal, which is, I also in language, language restrictions. Speaks in our mother tongue.
Hello, Aji. Hi, Sujit, everybody. That was wonderful. I just want to say I really enjoyed that. And, listening to two artists talk, one learns so much.
Thank you very much.
So that's really, and I have to tell you, I'm seeing Ajay's Trivandrum studio for the first time myself. Thanks to this session.
Thank you. Thank you for joining, Ranjana.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ranjana.
Hi, Ajay.
Hello.
Roy Thomas.
Anju.
Roy.
Hi, Roy.
I was listening from the very beginning, and I am very happy.
Yeah.
Both of you are talking very nicely. Very interesting, because no other artist, especially Indian artist, won't talk so openly in public. They consciously try to place themselves in history through lot many supports. I really like the way you are talking openly, talking about the actual issues, actual concerns.
And
Sujit was asking very nicely. Your language is not at all a problem. It was enjoyable to listening to you. Very nicely, you people were talking. Thank you,
Roy. If I wanted to get in the history, my painting had to do that, not me.
Yeah. But what I have seen, exactly. Others, they consciously try to place and pinpoint somewhere, you know, this is what exactly the history is.
My painting had to do that.
Very nice. Okay.
Thank you, Roy, to listen to me.
Thank you very
much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And Asa, we used to talk a lot, you know.
We used to talk. Let me tell you, means myself and Ajay started in Trivandrum together. And again, in Delhi, we studied in College of Art together. We are having a long association. We are from the same school, we can say. Okay. And there are a lot of parallel things going on. Means when I listen to him, I feel like I am listening to myself sometimes. You know.
No, Ajay is always encouraging. I rarely meet people like Ajay, because he's a dear friend of mine. Like, I must say that. And he push you, you know, like push you up on this thing, and he without any that sort of ego or any other problem.
No.
Like, he just push you to
Very confident about his art and what he is doing.
Yeah, he was very secure also.
He's feeling very secure whenever he speaks.
Yeah,
so he never tried to hide something or pull something.
That's true.
That is the real thing. That is why we like Ajay.
That's true.
100%. Okay, Ajay, bye.
Thank you very much.
So there are some questions in the chat. So first, from Shanti, she is asking about those elaborate headgears on the nude works. So what gives rise to those headgears, that Naga Baba, what were you called?
That headgear gives me a chance to draw. No? To draw very abstract things, to make them, you know, I can grow as long as I want. I can put them, make them as long as I want. You know, it's very free area. You know, that was the real reason, actually.
The adjusting the height.
Pardon?
Adjusting the height or what?
No, form. Everything.
Yeah, the balance, The balance, what we have discussed.
I can make the good balance, because if balance is not right, I can grow some more hair in one side.
That's amazing. It's like a tree, huh? Yeah.
Okay. So the second question, again from Shanti, she was asking that the landscapes are beautiful and surreal. So she's asking, are they intentionally surreal? Because the artist talks about doing landscapes because one day they will not exist. So when we look back, we then wonder, did this exist? So that surrealism, is it purposeful, intentional?
No, actually, these are made up landscapes. Now, I study landscapes, but when I make them, I make a painting, it's a made up thing. And I wanted to make it clear that it is a made-up thing. You know, it's it's on a canvas. It is, and the painter is painting them. So he is conscious about balance. He's conscious about his colors. He wanted to, so I don't hide that it is a made-up thing. So I make them as if they are in an aquarium, or not, like in an aquarium, we put plants and, you know, we put everything. So that way I arrange them, and I feel whatever I want. I bring the clouds, I bring the, you know, plants, I bring everything there, you know, and make my own landscape. And I get this from the nature. I get the take the clues from the nature, and with that I make them. So what I'm looking in the nature while doing nature studies, how it become, what is behind it, you know, all these things I am learning. And with that understanding, I make my own landscapes. So they are not real, you know, but they are not surreal also. They are paintings, you know.
Yeah, that's why
natural. There, that itself a natural becoming, like like an hill or white and eaten, you know, what we call wooden log or something. You know, it's becoming itself into that.
Yeah. That's why I asked that question. I added, in a way, that like it is, though it's very illogical, but or not very rational, but you are placing them into a rational ground.
The rationality of the painting.
Yeah, painting. Yeah. Needy, like our justice system. Yeah, that justice system you respect. Yeah.
Okay, so whether it is humans or trees, you should have a playground for distorting the form, right? So, okay, right. So Snake Mehra is asking, do you work on many works together?
Yes. Because sometimes paintings put me in a big trouble, like, then you don't have an answer. But you know that there should be an answer. There is an answer. There is a possibility of answer I see. So I put them apart and then come back to that. And also while I am doing oil painting, that, you know, it has to take time to dry and things like that. So if I am doing one painting, I have an urge to paint. You know, I really wanted to paint. So if there is no other chance, I will paint on the same thing and spoil the thing. So to escape from that, I make two paintings. Then I can paint on the other one, you know.
So second question from Snake again. She's asking, since you work in charcoal, pastel, oil, and acrylic, is there any favorite medium, or it is on depends on mood and time?
It depends upon our temperament, mood, and time. You know.
So this is raising the.
Hello.
Yep.
നമസ്കാരം അജിയേട്ടാ, സന്തോഷം. കൊറേ നാളുകൂടെ കണ്ടതില്. പിന്നെ ഞാൻ ചോദിക്കാൻ വന്നത്, ഇടക്ക് തിരുവനന്തപുരത്ത് ഒരു പ്രൊജക്ടിന് വേണ്ടിട്ട് ഒരു പഴയ വർക്ക് റീപ്രൊഡ്യൂസ്
ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്
സൈസില്. അപ്പൊ പ്രൊജക്ടറൊക്കെ വെച്ചിട്ട് അത് ചെയ്ത് കണ്ടായിരുന്നു. അപ്പൊ ഇത് സ്പെഷ്യൽ സർഫസ് ആണല്ലോ, ചുമരെന്ന് പറയുന്ന ഒരു സർഫസ്, ക്യാൻവാസ് എന്ന് വിട്ട്. അപ്പൊ അതെങ്ങനെ ആ വർക്ക് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞതിന് ശേഷം കണ്ടപ്പോ എങ്ങനെയാണ് അത് എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് ചെയ്തത്?
യഥാർത്ഥത്തിൽ ഡ്രോയിങ് പേപ്പർ ഓൺ ചാർക്കോൾ ഓൺ പേപ്പർ.
അതെ,
അത് എന്റെ മറ്റു ചില സുഹൃത്തുക്കള് അവര് റീപ്രൊഡ്യൂസ് ചെയ്താണ്. I have only responsibility for that, you know.
Okay.
That's a copy, you know. If they copy well, is, you know, I should congratulate them.
Okay. അല്ല, അത്രയും ആ സൈസിലായിരിക്കുമല്ലോ പേപ്പറിൽ ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടാവും. അപ്പൊ ഞാൻ അതായിരുന്നു ഉദ്ദേശം, ആ സൈസിലൊക്കെ കണ്ട സമയത്തുള്ള എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ്. നമ്മുടെ തന്നെ വർക്ക് ആ ഒരു സൈസിലൊക്കെ വരുമ്പോ എന്തായിരുന്നു തോന്നിയത്?
അത് നന്നായിരുന്നു. കാരണം വെച്ച് കഴിഞ്ഞാല് ഈ കൊറോണ സമയത്തെ ഗാദറിങ്സ് ഒക്കെ നമ്മൾ ഒഴിവാക്കുന്ന ഒരു സമയത്ത് ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള ഒരുപാട് ആൾക്കാർ കൂടി നിൽക്കുന്നതും, നമ്മളുടെ എന്താ പറയാ, കടപ്പുറത്ത് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഉത്സവം കാണാനൊക്കെ ആൾക്കാർ
നിൽക്കുക,
ഗാദറിങ്സ് ആണ്. അപ്പൊ അതൊക്കെ ഒരു ബാൻ ചെയ്ത സമയത്ത് ഇത്ര ഒരു സാധനം കാണുക എന്ന് പറയാൻ, interesting, you know, feeling.
പിന്നെ ഒരു ഒരു കാര്യം കൂടെ, ഞാൻ ഇപ്പം അജേട്ടൻ ഏതെങ്കിലും ഒരു ഷോയിൽ പോകുന്ന സമയത്ത്, എക്സിബിഷൻ കാണാൻ പോകുന്ന സമയത്ത് എങ്ങനെയായിരിക്കും എൻട്രി ചെയ്യുക? ഒരു നല്ല ഒരു സ്പേസ്, ഒരു വർക്ക്, പലതരം വർക്കുകളായിരിക്കുമല്ലോ ഉണ്ടാവുക, അപ്പോ എങ്ങനെയായിരിക്കും നല്ലത്, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ എനിക്ക് എൻട്രി ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്ന ഒരു സ്പേസ് എങ്ങനെയായിരിക്കും എടുക്കുക എന്നുള്ളത്? പല സമയത്തും പലതായിരിക്കും എന്നറിയാം,
എങ്കിലും യൂറോപ്പിലാണ് താമസിച്ചിരുന്നത്. നമ്മൾ നേരെ മ്യൂസിയത്തിലേക്ക് എൻട്രി ചെയ്യുമ്പോ തന്നെ ഒരു വർക്ക് നമ്മളെ ഭയങ്കരമായിട്ട് ആകർഷിക്കും. അതേപോലെ തന്നെയാണ് വാട്ട് ഈസ് കോളിംഗ് യു, അട്രാക്ടിങ് യു,
ഗോ
ദയർ. ഐ ഡോണ്ട് തിങ്ക് ദാറ്റ് ദിസ് ഈസ് ഡൺ ബൈ എ ഗ്രേറ്റ് മാസ്റ്റർ, സോ ഐ ഷുഡ് ഗോ ദയർ, ഓർ ഫേമസ് ആർട്ടിസ്റ്റ്, സോ ഐ ഷുഡ് ഗോ. ഐ ഡോണ്ട് ഡു ദാറ്റ്. നൗ വാട്ട് ഈസ് ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റ് മീ, വാട്ട് യു നോ, ദയർ ഐ ഗോ.
Thank you, Jetta. Thank you for your conversation.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you to visit, see our conversation.
So actually, Anjum was asking about a reproduced work of Achi, I think, in Trivandrum on a wall mural, if I understand it right.
Yes.
So he was asking, how does it look when it came in a much bigger surface and in a much bigger proportions? So Achi's telling that my responsibility only to my painting, which was on paper, and after that someone else reproduced it, but he somehow liked that stuff, you know. And also he feels like, you know, in a corona atmosphere, it was good to see a group of people doing that. Now the second question Anjum was asking is that when you enter a gallery space and an exhibition is going on, how do you get drawn or attracted to a specific work? Like, how does that process happen? So Aji says it's pretty simple. The work which calls you, it's not you which who decides. So the work, irrespective of who does it and decides and all, some works will be so much calling. So you just go towards that, whether it is in Europe or here. So that's what also, again, I understood. If there are corrections, you please
feel free.
Okay. So now Sarika Mehta is asking this question. She tells, I love the poetic atmosphere in your work from the starting, and what I feel is your work is about your process of doing it. I would love to hear about the process in your studio. What you listen? How do you see the process of painting?
Oh, that's a big question. What I listen? I listen music, classical music, all kind of music which has a kind of, you know, can keep my attention focused. Now, that kind of music I listen. Most of the time, classical music helped me to do that. All kind of classical music that keep me in focus. What was the next question?
I was asking, like, how do you see the process of your painting? How do you yourself see your process?
Now, it's like you are, you know, like the story of Vikram and Vedar. You try to get the Vedar, but then the Vedar asks you questions. Now, if you have answer, then the, you know, and that means, you know, the Vedal is gone. You have to go and catch him again. You know, then again it will ask you questions, and you answer. While answering, your painting, your integrity of the painting is again disrupted. So you go again and bring the Vedal back. So finally. You get a question which doesn't have any answer, you know, then it is done.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. So the next question, natural question, would be that where do you purchase this Vedal from? how do you mature as a person so that Vedal resides inside you? So that, how do you ask the right question?
You know, while painting, all these questions come in. Like when you are painting, you know, it arises in your own mind. This, you know, what you are doing, what is it, and all these things. So if you, you know, then you understand and you try to go along. Then you know, painting is not an answer of a question. So when you are trying to answer them, your art is gone. No. So that means the Vedal is gone. So you have to go back and bring it again. Then the new question will arise. No, you know, it goes like, if you know the story of Vedar and Vikram and Vedar, you know that. Finally, you know, there is a question which does not have an answer. You know, that's the end of the, you know, then it is done.
So as much as the question comes, the good question comes,
yeah,
your artist will survive, right? Like, yeah.
Yeah. Has to answer it.
Yeah. Yeah, true.
Yeah. Good, very good. Okay.
Can I?
Please.
Hi, Aji. Buddhadev Mukherjee speaking. Hi. Actually, I have no question. Actually, I enjoy your work, and in this art scenario, and according to the time, always we have a tendency as we grow up to, you know, before, you know, seeing the beauty of the work, talking about concept and the background story, a lot of things. But I, truly speaking, I always see your work. I wanted to, you know, reject these questions. I just enjoy your work because the beauty, calmness, and when I stand in front of your work, it's give me the peace. I think this is, I again, lot of things instead of asking question. So this is the power of your work, and what I feel, really I enjoy your work and I admire your work. So I have no question.
Just say one thing. I am not unaware of the realities, problems of the realities.
Yes, no, yes.
I am not unaware of the political situation of our land or the world. No, I am not unaware of about the ecosystems of the or problems of our world. No, I am aware about all these things, and my painting has all these things, but I am not particularly making a posture against that. You know?
Yes, yes. I also agree. Actually, your painting give all these answers. So, you know, as a painter, approach should be different. Not like, you know, they are speaking and explaining the painting.
No. I try to speak through
yes, yes.
through painting. You know, I mean the basic, how to say that? Through the color, through the, you know. Through the balance, through, you know, like basics of visual art. Now that is my medium.
So for that reason, I feel that you are a very, I'm not saying successful or that, you are a very powerful painter.
Thank you.
I really, for that reason, admire your work.
It's very nice of you. Thank you.
For showing and explaining a lot of your inner story, what we didn't get. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for appreciating my work. It's a great honor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So I think it looks like the questions are over. Can we wind up, Sujit?
I think, yeah, we can. Yeah.
Okay. So I think the journey which we started on first week of May in 2020, it ends here. So today we had a fantastic conversation, as all of you heard. So that is the beauty when two artists talk without any agenda, the real stuff comes out. That is so fantastic. So thank you, everyone. Especially thank you, Ajit, for agreeing to be part of this. Yeah, so the entire team, Narachatu, including Sujit, myself, and our entire team are thankful to all the people who supported us, who came here in Zoom every week, who appreciated the work, who saw the suggestions in Facebook, who supported to identify maybe the next week's artist, who suggested improvements. You know, a program has to roll on means, you know, you have so many hands working behind that, along with that. So we are thankful to all of you. If you take some names, I think it would be inappropriate, but then I think it goes without saying there are some of you who really stood with us all the time. But we are going to be back. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you for your support. And I'm extremely happy and, you know, honored to part of this and to have a conversation with Ajit. in the ending, you know, like I'm so happy that like we had a, I think I really enjoyed this talk.
Thank you for everything. I put that.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Sadish, and thank you, Nirachat, yeah. Team Nirachat, and for giving me this opportunity.
Okay, fine. So we will close the Zoom.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
We can close the Zoom. This is hosted from another team.
Who is doing that? Me?
I have two meetings.
Okay.
One second.
Ajay, Sujit, this is Parvati. I just wanted to say I really enjoyed that, and how nice to see two friends together. Hi, Ajay. It's after so long having a chance to talk to you. So this is wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you.
And yeah, so lovely.
Thank you, Parvati. Thank you.